This meeting, the Oskaloosa City Council to order. Today is Monday, July 17th, 2017. We start with the invocation by J.D. Duval, Jubilee Family Church. Yeah, in that case, we fall back on me. Heavenly Father, as we assemble here tonight, we thank you for the blessing of the people in this room. We have all felt your call to be part of the future of Oskaloosa and acknowledge the need for your guidance. For the council members and staff here, we ask that you bless us. Give us quiet, considerate attitudes, well-thought-out deliberations, and ultimately, decisions that are best for the long-term future of the city of Oskaloosa. We thank you for those in the audience here and watching in the broadcast. We thank you for leaders of businesses and organizations who have the vision and commitment to help the city. The countless volunteers who are motivated to help, and for informed citizens who have given us the privilege of their trust and support. So tonight we have assembled a group of people who are making a difference in the long-term future of Oskaloosa. So may the words of our mouths and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, please.
Burnett.
Here.
Caligari.
Here.
Jimenez.
Here.
Moore.
Here.
Brisset.
Here.
Walling.
Here.
Yates.
Here.
Okay, thank you. First item up on the agenda is the opportunity for community comments. It's reserved to receive comments from the community for concerns whether or not they're included on the current agenda. The community is encouraged to come and speak before the mayor and city council, asked to keep statements brief, time limited to no more than 3 minutes. Any questions are to be asked of the city staff, the council members, or the mayor prior to speaking to the full council, so perhaps the concerns can be properly researched and answered away from the meeting. Comments are to be directed to the mayor and city council only. Is there anyone who would like to speak at this time? Seeing none, we'll move on. Next item on the agenda is the consent agenda. These are items that are routine in nature and get handled by a single vote. I would draw the council's attention to item F, where we have the appointment to the Building Code Board of Appeals with Royce Spolstra. And then also item I, this has to do with the scheduling of a public hearing on August 21st of 2017, of course, to consider levying a special assessment against private property for weed cutting. There are 17 properties that will be considered at that time. Do we have a motion supporting this this agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Anything to take off or talk about?
I have a couple of questions on I. Levying the assessment. I know it's just a public hearing, but my first question, when I looked at all the 17 on the list, I noticed the first three was at $50 and all the rest of them were at $250. What was the issue with the first three? The
first three had invoices that were sent out with the incorrect amount, $200. And so we had to readjust and send another $50 notice because they have in fact, did they end up paying Amy the $200?
They didn't pay it, yes.
Yes, but they hadn't paid the additional $50. So they were sent another notice letting them know that the actual amount should have been $250.
Okay.
They haven't paid, and so here we are.
All right, and then I noticed we have several that are against the railroad. Is that something that...
We're charging enough.
Well,
they think it's cheap to get their stuff mowed.
When that goes on, I mean, the railroad property is probably not going to change change hands, and so on, something like that, does it just go on the tax rolls and stay there kind of forever?
It will. The fire chief has reached out to them, and they said that they're going to have them all paid before it gets to that stage.
Oh, okay.
But historically, they've paid. It's never actually...
Yeah, it just takes a little bit for them to pay, but this process takes a little while to get through the assessment. So, but if not, we have talked to the treasurer's office, and we have turned... they will take them, and they will track collecting them through the procedures just like everybody else.
And then the last one I have a question on about is, refresh my memory on how we contact people again to let them know before we mow, or is there a contact, or is it just put in the paper? I just want reminded how we do that.
So on, and the fire chief could probably speak to this since it's a nuisance enforcement issue. Go ahead, Chief.
Council, we, when the ordinance change comes through, the procedure now is to go out, locate the properties, give 3 days notice on allowing the property owners to get it corrected on their own. If the property is occupied, we post a property. If it's a vacant lot, we try to reach out to the property owners that way. If we feel like if there's a building on the property, but it's unoccupied, we then go back and try to research and make contact with that property owner, which we have done. If we're unable to do that, after 3 days, it's still not in compliance, and we contact our mower. They come in, or a contractor, they come in and clean up the property.
So the change of the ordinance that council approved was May 1st of this year with an effective date of May 8th, I believe. And I think all of you were contacted by a gentleman through email.
I didn't know that all of us got it. I know I got it. But
yeah, he did as well.
His property was mowed on the 18th.
So in that one, since it was a rental, I think what he described to us, it would have been one where it would have just been posted on the property.
I posted on the property, and then what I did with that, I actually was the one that cited that one, or wrote it up. We went back to Beacon. I couldn't get anybody to answer the door there. So I went back to the Beacon website to find out who the owner was, tried to reach out to them, unlisted phone number. It was an out-of-town person. I had really no other way of trying to figure out how to make contact with them. I did print off a picture of the property. It's that was, as you can see from the picture, it wasn't just a little bit tall, it was extremely tall. So I we tried to reach out to staff to that individual.
Okay, and I know we'll have the actual chance for that person to come and speak. I recommended they do that when we have it, but I just could not remember how we were doing that. I thought we'd made a change, so thank you.
Okay, anyone else?
Okay. I don't want to pull anything, Tom. I was asking Tom if he wanted to pull something.
Doug said he'd take it over.
He did a nice job.
He did a nice job.
Congratulations. Slow this right down. Roll call, please.
Moore?
Yes.
Dickerson?
Yes.
Wally?
Yes.
Yates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Caligiuri?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Getting into the regular agenda, first item up is a resolution levying a special assessment against private property for cleanup to abate a nuisance. It's the time for a public hearing on levying special assessment against property owned by the estate of Sandra K. Thompson at 412 North 8th Street in Oskaloosa for cleanup to abate a nuisance. A certified notice of the hearing was sent to the property owners, and notice of the hearing was published in the Oskaloosa Herald prior to the public hearing date. On August 29th of 2016, staff left initial violation notice and spoke with the individual occupying the property. A recheck of the property on September 14 of 2016 found no change with the accumulation of trash and junk on the real estate. Staff prepared a documentation and forwarded to the city attorney for legal action. The city clerk prepared an assessment schedule listing and showing the costs of the abatement, and a copy is attached to our agenda. The assessment on the property was levied by the city council on April 17 of 2017 with resolution number 17-04-57. An error was found on the assessment schedule, and the city attorney advised repeating the full assessment process for correction. So I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone who would like to speak to it at this time? Okay, seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. Do we have a motion supporting the special assessment to abate the nuisance?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Brusay?
Yes.
Walling?
Yes.
Yates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Calgery?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item B is consider a resolution that levying a special assessment against private property for sidewalk replacement. And this is the time for a public hearing on levying the assessment against private properties for sidewalk replacement. They're outlined in Exhibit A. There's three properties there. Total is about $294. The certified notices were sent to each property owner, and a notice was published in the Oskaloosa Herald. If approved, the property owner has 30 days from the time of filing with the Mahaska County Treasurer to pay for the sidewalk replacement in the city clerk's office. And then after the 30 days, it will be assessed to their property taxes with a payment schedule at 9% interest. I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone who would care to speak to this tonight? Seeing none, we'll close the public hearing. Do we have a motion supporting the resolution for the special assessments?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion?
So these people have either not said anything or said they won't pay? Is that?
They've either contacted us and said put it on their assessment or haven't paid. And I don't know, Keelish, if you have any notes on that, but I don't know specifically.
So they can request that as a payment means.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks, Mike.
Any further comments? Roll call, please.
Walling?
Yes.
Yates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Calgery?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Brusay?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item C is a request from MCRF, or Mahaska Community Recreation Foundation, to report on their quarterly activities. I thought I saw Sherry Vavra here.
Sherry's here. Hi, guys.
Hi.
Hello. We rested up after July 15th, Christmas. Busy day. This was for second quarter. You guys got this in your package, and we're always busy second quarter. That's the quarter tonight. And we had soccer wrapped up this season with their little camp, and we had 50 little tiny kids out there playing soccer, so we're going to keep pictures of them. T-ball was also joined Little League this year, so that increased Little League and gave us 50 more games. We had a couple of challenger games this year from Imagine Possibility, and then the elementary and the schools come over. We held track meets at the stadium. I mean, you guys know what goes on out there. Every sport that's in the spring was all out there. So community sport was great this time. We did have a Bill Almond, who has done like 27 plus years in Babe Ruth, got inducted into the Babe Ruth Hall of Fame this quarter, and it was kind of exciting because he is also an MCRF board member, just saying, and now he's a Babe Ruth Hall of Famer, so that was kind of good just for him, as much as he's dedicated to the kids. We did finish some ADA sidewalks for our Babe Ruth lower fields, and we put lights up so we can play even more games for Babe Ruth. Then we dedicated the Drost soccer field as well. So what's coming up is a picnic area. We're going to put that across from the stadium in that field that's blank, and we're going to put five different little areas. So there will be private picnic area and then a group picnic area as well. And we got a grant for that this year, and we're working on a solar walkway sun dome system that will be out there, so that's kind of moving along. Van Corps Group is coming, a drum corps is coming next weekend. If you guys want to come out, they're doing a Saturday night, they'll do a performance for everybody. And then we just had, this was written before we had it, but we just had yesterday with Christmas in July, Saturday actually, Christmas in July, another urban park competition. And I was really proud of the kids because they raised $1,200 to make sure that it happened, and they did it without me. The kids did it, so it was great. And the competition went off really well. So that's the things that are going on. Trail tram rides are still available, so if you guys want to ride, we'll ride those for another couple months. Okay? Questions?
Thank you.
All right.
That's awesome.
Okay, very good. Thank you, Sherry.
Thanks, Sherry.
Next up is the item D, presentation of the second quarter code enforcement report. Fire department should be giving us a brief presentation on nuisance enforcement activities for the second quarter.
He can read it.
TV sideways.
Sorry?
That was upside down. I had to just turn the TV sideways, but he figured I had to read out doing that. So.
I think we'd all went to sleep with a head tilt there. Okay, so I'm here to give you the second quarter, April through June 2017 code report. The second quarter activity, I apologize, it's not as colorful. I'm going to have to change the way the file was a little bigger, and we didn't do it the right way, apparently, because it's not color this time. So I apologize for that. In April, as you can see, the total numbers down there at the bottom, we had 38 total properties that we made contact with. Of those, 20 were closed. 12 of those were owner-occupied, and 26 were rental. Now, one thing that we're working on with the water department in this, I know there's been some talk with rental inspections and what properties are sold on, might be sold on, sitting out there on contract and things like this. We know in this particular go-round, we had four properties that are sold on contract, but they're not showing up on the city website or the Beacon website as such, as two separate owners. We're trying to work with the water department and cross-reference who it's deeded to, but who the water bill is going to. So we're trying to work through some of these things that are coming up in our system, and we think it's probably going to assist as the rental inspection rolls out too, because technically they're showing up as rentals, but we know we've talked to the people and they said, well, we're buying this on contract. I said, well, on the code side, it really doesn't matter. We're just trying to track that stuff just as information for us. So moving on to May was a little bigger month. As you can see, that the big uptick there was grass and weeds when it really picked up. We had 55 total public contacts or property contacts. 43 of those were closed out. 14 of those were owner occupied, and this particular month, the rental side was up substantially. It had been running 50-50. But this one picked up a little bit because of we believe it's probably the mowing that had played into that. Moving into June, the rain kind of stopped, so our mowing slowed down substantially, but we still ended up with 10 grass and weeds. We'll get into a summary side of it here. We've had a lot of dilapidated structures that we've been working on over the past. Trying to let that siren get out of here a little bit so you can hear me. Hard surface parking has not been, everybody's starting to kind of get the idea on that one. As we've been out, we're not seeing near the violation. We'll still see them once in a while, but not as many. So here's the wrap up. We had a total of 115 properties contacted. 69 of those were closed out. Four cases were sent to city attorney. So we've got a lot of open cases sitting out there that are in the legal processes now. We've had a couple court hearings over the past month or so that judgments have come through. In fact, I just saw another judgment come through today that we'll be working on figuring out how we want to proceed with that particular property. Um, 66% of the violations have been resolved without the city attorney or fire department taking any other action. So that's down a little bit from last quarter, 84%, and that's a direct result of the mowing that had to be done. That's where the fall off went on people being compliant was the mowing. So as you can see, we're still tracking. We had 116 on the first quarter, 97 were closed, Second quarter, we had 115, so roughly the same amount of contacts out there. Of those, only 69 were closed. So we have had to do a little more work forward, either through the city attorney or just staff working with the owner occupants, trying to get this cleared up. It's up just a little bit on our hours from last quarter per violation. Again, that was a, we think that's a direct result of the mowing, having to go around with the first time around with the mow contractor, showing them the properties and getting them to know the area a little bit. So we've got some before and afters here. This has been a, this
quick,
is,
quick
yep,
question.
Absolutely.
Two quarters, we had 231 properties that we considered nuisances. Any idea how many properties we would have in the community? What's our pool?
So just from doing some, this is on the residential side, there are 4,000, between 4,000 to 5,000, maybe 4,500 roughly.
Okay. So if this trend would continue, we'd have 10% of them we would hit throughout the course of the year, roughly. I just wanted an idea. Thank you.
Do we keep numbers on repeat offenders?
Yeah. Yeah, I don't. I can put that in the next report, that's for sure.
That'd be great.
I mean, we're starting to know those by addresses anymore. Okay. They flag up relatively, and I shouldn't say relatively regular, but we have some that that we see more often than not.
And that's important, that's for sure. Because obviously, with repeat offenses, we have the ability to abate those
yes.
problems quicker. And so, yeah, we absolutely want to track those and have that
okay.
information.
Great.
Anything else before I go into some of the before and after? Okay. So this is 115 Southbound. I'm sure everybody's well aware of which property this is. This is one that we've. This is one of our. Frequent flyers, I guess, for lack of a better term, that we've been on. So as you can see, there's a structure built there with tarps around it. The picture on the right is garbage. The truck is backed in there. Again, we went in to abate this one. This is the same angle of where the garbage was sitting, so it's cleaned up. Again, the before and after.
I guess before you move on, Mark,
yep.
a quick note about that particular individual. Although he owns that property for now, the violations have in fact been shifted over to another property. So he's has an RV and he has kind of a trailer that he's moved to a different property in the same neighborhood, which apparently is where his parents live. So it's not like the problem's been completely resolved. It has at this property, but it's been moved.
And by the way, an infraction has just been filed on that too.
Anything else on that one? Okay. So here's a before picture of 308 B Avenue West. As you can see, they had quite a bit of stuff on their front porch. We went over, made contact with them. This was a property owner that was very receptive to us. As you can see from the picture, they've got it cleaned up. It's a really pretty nice little
property.
Well,
that's a nice looking little house there.
It is.
So, yeah.
And like I say, they were very receptive. They understood. They had it done within a couple days. You know,
didn't they move out?
Wasn't any big issue there.
Pardon? Didn't they move?
Well, they could have. It might have been the...
I'm thinking somebody else is in there now.
Somebody else in there now.
I think they were just in there temporary anyway. They had
okay.
junk all over the place.
Okay. Yeah.
They had a yard sale.
Yeah.
It was one that, again, it didn't take very long to really get it squared up. They were pretty receptive to us. Here's another one. This is 509 South 5th Street. And what you're looking at here is, on the left is an alley shot. And on the right is the other side of the house, the structure. So this is a before picture. This was on, I can't see the dates. I apologize. I think it's 5-8,
yeah.
maybe 8. Here's the same shot of the house after they got everything cleaned up and moved. Again, this one didn't have to go to court or anything. We just worked with the property owner, and they were able to get it cleaned up. So some of the long-term projects, I know this is 1118 7th Avenue East. We've abated this property multiple times now. We abated it. You'll see some of the before pictures here of March 2017, and then in April of 2017, that's a photo of us abating it. Then we went back in June, and we had some of the same issues. This person has been, he's not living there anymore. The property has been, got new renters in it. Thus far, we haven't had any issues over there with it. Here's another problem property that we've dealt with. This is 1327 9th Avenue East. This was an abatement we did on some vehicles. I think I showed you that one. That was then just prior to, that would have been probably in the first quarter, right at the end of the first quarter. Then these photos are when the Public Works came in, took all the gravel out, reseeded it, and got the impervious surface problem that was on that property corrected. Then, whoops, darn it. Then it was, I believe that's July 3rd, that motorhome showed up on that same property within just a few weeks.
So that's 9th Avenue East.
That is the same property, that is 9th Avenue East. That motorhome showed up just a few weeks after we had abated both the vehicles and the gravel out of it. I took that picture. That motorhome's no longer there either. We've since moved it. I drive by there now pretty regularly. I haven't seen anything else come in on it. But again, that was moved out on July 3rd. A couple other long-term projects, and this is just kind of when we get into the court system, it's just an idea of how things can get a little bit drawn out. 807 South C, we've had violations for that one in 2014, 15, 16, and 17. Most recent was notified in 2016, and we were able to close that out in April. So if property owners, you know, if we have to go through the legal process, it takes a little bit longer to get things accomplished. Another one was 412 North H. That one we had violations in 2016. The city filed for an abandoned property in November of 2016. The hearing was set for February of 2017, but then it got moved to August for...
That one was moved, by the way, because there's an estate that's been opened.
Yes.
There. The attorney got in touch. He promised me they were going to be selling the property, and I'd understood the neighbors were anxious to buy it, but it's still sitting there. Nothing has happened, so we're rolling around to the new hearing date.
And in fact, that's the one I think that you just redid the assessment on
tonight, this evening.
So anybody have any questions on this quarter? Anything you'd like to see included or changed? I guess I'm going to fire one out at you.
Just the frequent flyers. The frequent flyers. I'd like to see those.
Okay.
Like you just did there, 2014, 15, 16, and 17.
Okay.
And then I have a question not pertaining to this. The property at the corner of D and 92, pharmacy. Mm-hmm. The weeds are a foot and a half tall there. Right on the, you know, on the frontage.
Yep.
Road or whatever you want to call it. That's the main thoroughfare going through town.
Yep.
How do we do there?
Yeah, we'll make contact with them.
Okay.
Yeah, we've had to mow that 10-foot strip at least once that I'm aware of. The property itself doesn't look very good either, the building.
No, it doesn't.
It's
horrible.
Kind of falling apart, so it's kind of a interesting balance because obviously we've had some interactions with the South D project and trying to figure out what we're going to do with that particular entrance and trying to acquire that the road project. So got a lot of things going on there, and that property hasn't been in operation as far as a business since January. So we're trying to figure that out.
I drive by it every day, so I mean, with all seriousness, it's a main drag through town. I'll just bring my weed eater and take me literally 5 minutes to take it down. And just the main drag through town shouldn't look like that. I don't care what we got going on with this guy. So whatever it's worth. It's right away, right? So I just think main drag through town, I look a little nicer. So
anything else for Mark? Thank you very much,
Mark. Thanks, Mark.
Did you have any other slides that you wanted to show us?
What about the save the date page?
save the date page. So I put that on there so I wouldn't forget. And then I wouldn't forget.
You didn't forget.
Goodness.
We're getting to it.
So August, save the date. August 3rd, 2 p.m., 2 in the afternoon. We're going to have our dedication ceremony. I'm guessing the ceremony itself might last 30 minutes or so. We will have an open house after that. Up until 9 or 9:30, we kind of set that for the band plays that night. We thought we might have a lot of folks coming into town, so we will be open till 9 or 9:30. Or the last person decides they want to leave. We'll have some refreshments and stuff there. And like I said, I'd just like to make sure the general public comes up too because it's their building.
Is the mayor speaking at that?
I have asked the mayor to speak.
Well, you said a half an hour. That's why I was just looking at you. So.
Yeah. Otherwise, it would be 5 minutes. I've got a few things I want to let out. Okay. Thank you, Mark.
Thanks, Mark.
Thank you.
Moving on to item E. This is approval of a change order number 3. It's in the amount of $48,532.56. And pay request number 14 in the amount of $34,143.30 comes to a total of $82,675.86 to be paid to DDBI Incorporated, and that's for work completed on the Oskaloosa Fire Department expansion and renovation project. Items included on the pay request are the floor installation, the plumbing fixture installation, mechanical installation, cabinet installation, and kitchen appliances. And then also included in the pay request on change order number 3, that's a $48,500 change order. I noticed in the listing that $37,700 of it is the apparatus bay floor. So do we have a motion supporting this change order?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion?
Mayor, if I may.
Absolutely.
There was a handout up there that you need to replace the one that's in your packet with this one. There was an error that was my fault. We ended up locating it Friday. I went through with DDBI and the city clerk. It was an error on my part. The math was all correct on there. However, the numbers weren't matching up with the pay request numbers. And what I had done is I had actually subtracted the $70,561 and change twice. So this new sheet, the highlighted stuff that is in there, separating out the change orders is what got me in trouble. So now I put the change orders in with the pay requests. So now it flows together, the numbers all match up, and we're square. So it fits in. It was an error that I found Friday. Everybody found it.
What's your feeling on the change orders and on the general construction of the fire department?
City manager and I spoke just a little bit this morning when I brought this to his attention that if you take out the $14,000 that we knew for that we'd left out for the data processing, and then the $37,000 that we really need to do for the apparatus bay, that takes a lot of this. You know, a lot of change orders out of it. There was one question that city manager posed to me today, or this morning, was how did we miss getting bathroom sinks in? That was a question that
I was
prepped for. What had happened was through the process of redesigning that upstairs, all those items got put into the master plan. However, each individual contractor gets a separate set of plans, and they did not make it into the plumbing plan, if that makes sense.
So it was an architect's mistake?
Yes.
Contractor didn't leave it out. It wasn't there.
Well, it was in the main big stack of plans. It just didn't get transferred into the smaller stack that each individual mechanical contractor would get. The flooring contractor, the paint schedule, those smaller ones, so they don't have to shuffle through the big packets, the large blueprints.
Now that you've been living there for a little bit, what's everybody think?
The staff was very, very pleased with it. We're working now. It seems like the last little bit here is, I don't want to say stalled out at all, but those small ticket things seem to take a little more time. Anybody that's been through a construction process knows that it goes up really fast, and then when you finally get down that last little bit of the detail work, again, it just takes a little bit of time. Somebody will nickel all here is when the painter's got to come back, or there'll be a little hiccup here and there. The oil canning, they have got the south side they put new fascia up on the south side. They have got the rest of it will be going up sometime yet this week. We'll have a final walkthrough with DDBI Wednesday, and then the architects will be down Friday to try to get that last punch list.
There's still quite a hump in the gravel stop on the south side.
Excuse me?
There's still quite a hump on the gravel stop on the south side.
Yeah, we've mentioned that. That's one thing that we've mentioned to them. The fascia itself has come in pretty good. There's still I don't know what that is, but there's still something up there that is we're looking at. So that hasn't been ignored. Staff, again, to answer that question directly, staff, we're liking the operations area of it. It's working well for us. Everybody's ready to, we were really thankful last week to get a stove and stuff back, so we don't have to, we've been microwaving it for two or three months, so having stuff carried in. So staff was happy to kind of get back those type of amenities. Mm-hmm.
We still need a roll call, don't we?
Yes.
Roll call, please.
Yates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Caligiuri?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Verstay?
Yes.
Wally?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item F. Now, this is a resolution approving the 9th Avenue East curb and gutter replacement project. It's been prepared by staff. Scope of the project includes replacement of 950 feet of curb and gutter, plus 100 square yards of street pavement along 9th Avenue East from South 7th Street over to South 11th. Section of 9th Avenue East receives a significant volume of truck traffic, and portions of the curb and gutter and some areas of the street pavement have failed. Therefore, the staff is recommending to use the annual street maintenance funds to repair the deteriorated curb and gutter and the pavement sections in order to prolong the useful life of the street. Estimated cost of the project was $44,625. Bid information was emailed to 9 local concrete contractors. Bids were received on Friday, June 30th, with the lowest and only bid being from TK Concrete for $37,500. And so during the project construction, at least one lane will remain open to traffic at all times. Contractors have been instructed to limit work to one side of the street at a time. Start date for the project to be determined by the contractor with the stipulation that the entire project is completed by October 20th. Duration of the construction will depend on the weather, estimated at around 3 to 4 weeks. If council awards the construction contract, staff is recommending authorizing an additional $2,000, which is about 5% of the contract, as a construction contingency for anything unforeseen, and then also authorize the mayor to execute all the related contract documents. Do we have a motion supporting this resolution?
Move.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? Roll call, please.
Burnett? Burnett?
Yes.
Bellinger?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Persay?
Yes.
Walling?
Yes.
Yates?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Item G. This is to consider a resolution denying the attempt by Mahaska County to amend, terminate, and withdraw from the current 2080 agreement between Mahaska County, the City of Oskaloosa, and the City of Pella for the proposed regional airport project. On June 19th of 2017, the Mahaska County Supervisors approved in a split vote Resolution Number 2017-12, a resolution to amend, terminate, and withdraw from a 2080 agreement with the City of Pella and the City of Oskaloosa regarding the joint acquisition, construction, equipping, use, expansion, and operation of an airport facility. On July 3rd of 2017, the City of Pella approved their Resolution Number 5781. It's a resolution denying the attempt by Mahaska County to remove all references of Mahaska County in the current 2080 agreement between Mahaska County, the City of Oskaloosa, and the City of Pella for the proposed regional airport. Any amendments to the existing 2080 agreement require approval from all three participating entities, and the city's legal counsel does not believe Mahaska County has the ability to unilaterally make changes to the current 2080 agreement without the approval of the City of Oskaloosa and the City of Pella. So staff is recommending that the City Council approve a resolution denying the attempt by Mahaska County to amend, terminate, and withdraw from the current 2080 agreement between Mahaska County, the City of Oskaloosa, and the City of Pella for the proposed regional airport project. Do we have a motion supporting this resolution?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? It is my understanding the wording of this resolution matches that of the City of Pella. Is that correct?
There's some slight variations in the wording, but they're essentially doing the same thing.
Okay. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Caligiuri?
Yes.
Jimenez?
Yes.
Moore?
Yes.
Persay?
Yes.
Walling?
Yes.
Yates?
Yes.
Burnett?
Yes.
Okay, that passes. Gets us to the end of the agenda. Reports from city staff, city manager.
Mayor and council, the only item I had was the rental inspection program update, and this is just a reminder for all of you and anybody out there that who has a rental property, it must be registered by the end of this month. Obviously, the program documents talk about there is a grace period until the end of the following month, but we're really encouraging property owners to register by the end of this month so that we can have a good handle on the number, just the pure volume of properties that we are faced with addressing through this program. That's all.
Okay. City clerk, anything?
No, sir.
City attorney, anything?
Nothing, thank you.
Okay. City council members, Steve Burnett.
Yep, just congratulations to the baseball and the softball team both, and good luck to you this week. So,
okay. Tom?
No, sir.
Nothing tonight, sir.
Okay.
Nothing, sir.
Nothing.
Yeah, Mike, anything on Bob Matrician yet?
Mayor and Council, I have not reached out to Mr. Matrician yet. That's on my to-do list. So, nothing yet, but
you're
think
still working on a letter or something?
Based on the previous conversation, it appears there's a workable solution for his needs, and we're not starting construction until next year, but I will absolutely get with them.
Thank you.
Joe, anything?
Just something real quick. Scotty and myself were appointed to that housing committee for the City of Oskaloosa, and today we had our first meeting, about an hour and a half. Not much to report on it. We just basically did some brainstorming. There's been some proposed sites for new housing, and we're meeting again, Mike, August 1st, is it? August 1st, we're going to meet again, and by that time we'll have more of an agenda by that time, but we've got a couple action items out of today's meeting, so there's not much to say. I just want to let you know we had our first meeting today about housing.
Okay, very good.
So, more yet to come on that.
Yeah, lots more to come.
A lot more.
Yeah, I wanted to mention a couple of things. First off, expressing gratitude for all the work that went into the Christmas in July celebration that went on over the weekend. It does my heart a lot of good to be out in the community, especially for all of the people that were in the town square over the weekend. The work that was done with the activities for families, the splash pad that was out there, that was a hoot just to sit there and watch. the efforts that were made in the alley as well. That the Alley Cats organized a Legacy of Excellence ceremony, I guess, for Steve Bell. And so along with that was the opportunity for me to award Steve a key to the city. Now, and that's when you start to realize just how tight-knit the community is, that the idea was floated about a week and a half before the actual ceremony. One phone call to Dave Anderson at Cloud Valve, who is the foundry manager, and I had to leave a voicemail for him, so I didn't know how that was going to work. A couple hours later, I get a call back, and he has John Grayheck and Paul Callahan with him, saying, yes, we can absolutely do this, and will. So, okay, fine, leave it in our hands, we'll get back to you next week. So then, in the meantime, Dave Anderson takes off on vacation. That leaves it in the hands of John Grayheck. John Grayheck needs to go to California. And so, now here's where I'm thinking, okay, but Cloud Valve has a reputation, when they say they're gonna do something, they do something. And so, after a couple of days, I contacted Paul Callahan, who was kind of handed the project, and he said, yeah, that Dave Anderson didn't think it was good enough just to make a key to the city. He also needs to have it routed in an eighth inch deep into finished mahogany so that way it can be put on a wall. Okay, and he said, I'm doing it now, and you'll get it very quickly here. It's just about completed. Thursday, I'm out of the office most of the day. Friday, I'm in meetings all day. There's messages that are hitting my voicemail from Paul Callahan saying, hey, I've got this thing done. How do I get it to you? And in the meantime, he just hopped in a car and brought it out. So I found it on my desk waiting for me 2 days before we had the actual ceremony. And then when the ceremony took place, everything fell together magnificently. We had good publicity with people saying this is what's going on. Steve appeared to be just thrilled for the amount of community affection that was shown for him, and boy, as I told him, I said, I think that was a two-way street, that not only did the community appreciate him, but his outreach to the community, reminding people of what his childhood was like and the values that were instilled in him as he went out and launched his career, it just made Oskaloosa look real good and made us all feel very good. And then the last thing is the home base initiative that is going to be going on the 24th of July. That is going to be, I believe, at 10:30 on July 24th. We will have Lieutenant Governor here, and Adam Gregg will be speaking along with other people, other dignitaries, I'm sure. So I wanted to remind people that that is happening. It is 10:30 in the morning on the 24th. That's it for me. Do we have a motion to adjourn?
Move.
I'll move.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
We're adjourned.